Hi and welcome. Today we're gonna take a look into this nice 486 motherboard. It is based on a UMC chip which has a sticker on it with the marking UM83C3498. I am not sure why they would put a sticker on it though. It has a proper circuitry PGA socket and it has a voltage regulator for the 3V CPUs. It has both 72-pin and 30-pin SIM sockets, which is nice, and it is using an ODIN RTC12C8087A clock module. Upon a closer look, I could see some signs of rework. These capacitors seem to have been replaced, but other than that, I don't see any damage traces or anything really wrong with it. Before powering it on, let's check for short circuits on the power pins. I am attaching the negative lead of the multimeter to the keyboard connector. No short circuits with the rest of the power pins, that's good. But hold on! I'm not getting continuity even on the ground pin. This is very strange, it appears that the metallic shield of the keyboard connector is not grounded. Anyway, let me attach the negative lead to the actual ground pin of the power connector and try again. And yeah, I don't see any short circuits, so it should be safe to power it on. Let me plug in the post-diagnostic card. The board seems to power on, which is good. Now, before I plug in the CPU, I need to make sure that the voltage on the CPU socket is correct. I'm going to use this small header to tap onto the socket pins. I'm getting 3.4 volts, which suggests that the jumper settings are for a 3V CPU and the voltage regulation circuit works. Now let's check the FSB frequency at pin C3. It is at 25 MHz. To configure this board properly, I will need to get hold of its manual. The retroweb.com is usually the best place to look for one. I am not sure about the model number of this board, but according to the retroweb.com, it seems to be similar to a Biostar MB-1425 UIV, though that one is missing the RTC module. Anyway, the jumpers seem to match the ones on my board, so I will set up my motherboard according to that board's manual. The board has three jumpers that control the FSB. I'm going to follow Necroware's advice and use jumpers of a different color. I'm using yellow for the FSB jumpers and red for the voltage jumpers. After setting the jumpers correctly, we're getting 33 MHz FSB. I configured all jumpers according to the manual, so let's plug in my 486DX 33 MHz 5V CPU. And yeah, we're getting some postcodes. Let's plug in this VGA card based on the Cirrus Logic CL-GD5426 chip. This chip is nothing special, but it'll do the job. Nice, the system is posting. As expected, the BIOS is complaining that the CMOS battery is low. These RTC modules have a built-in, non-replaceable battery, so most of them have a dead battery by now. I'm going to replace the whole module with my NWx287 based board. If you're not familiar with it, I made a video about it a while back. In short, it is a plug-in replacement board for several RTC modules. It is based on Necroware's NWx287 with some tweaks, the main one being that it works with a regular CR2032 battery. The RTC module on my board is not socketed, so I will need to desolder it. I'm wetting the solder joints with some fresh solder. Next, I'm using a desoldering gun to remove the solder. It looks like it's working, as most of the solder has been removed, but actually most of the pins are still soldered firmly onto the pads. So I'm going to use some hot air to safely pry out the chip. Now let's install a socket. And let's install my NWx287 board. And success! The battery warning is now gone. Okay, let's try out my DX266 CPU. Let's configure the voltage at 3.3 volts. It does not seem to be booting. Strange. I double checked all the jumpers and I could still not get it to work. I know that the CPU works because I pulled it from another working system. I tried once again the 33MHz DX CPU and... disaster! I accidentally inserted the CPU the wrong way, with the notch incorrectly positioned at the opposite corner of the socket. I heard a crackling noise coming from the CPU right after I powered it on, and when I touched the CPU to check what was wrong, it was so hot that it burned the tip of my finger. I immediately turned the power off, but it was too late. The DX33 CPU was dead, and the socket had a burn mark on pin B4. But the big question is whether the board still works. The 486DX is a 5V part, so the power comes directly from the power supply. So even though I short-circuited the board by inserting the CPU the wrong way, there won't be any damage to the voltage regulation circuit. But perhaps some of the power traces on the PCB may have burned out. But upon closer inspection, I didn't see any visible damage. Let's try to see if I can boot the system with my trusted DX4 on a 486 voltage blaster board. The CPU does not seem to overheat, that's good. And yeah, I'm seeing text on the screen. The board is alive. But what about the damage on the socket? Let's check it out with the help of this header. According to the socket pinout, this is a ground pin. And yeah, it is still connected to ground, great. I could try to remove the burn mark by scraping it off with a small file, but I think I will leave it as is, as a reminder to always check the orientation of the CPU. But what about the DX266 that I could not get to work? At this point, it dawned on me that perhaps the DX2 CPU is a 5V part, not a 3.3V as I had assumed. And indeed, according to the CPU world, it runs on 5V. After configuring the jumpers correctly and plugging it in on the damaged motherboard, the system booted just fine. That was very silly of me. Okay, let's try out some benchmarks. Strange, it seems to be running really slow. Let me try SpeedSys. Wow, I'm getting a score of 9.65, which is very low. A DX266 should be around 25. And the memory graphs look very strange. Perhaps the caches are disabled, but as expected, both caches are already enabled in the BIOS. I also tried the cache check tool, and indeed the caches do not seem to be working. Normally, I would double check the motherboard jumpers to make sure that the L2 cache is configured properly, but this time it was both the L2 and L1 caches that were not working. And the L1 is built into the CPU, it usually works fine out of the box. I even tried CPU SPD, but this also reported that the L1 cache was enabled, and enabling it didn't change a thing. This was indeed very strange. I thought that the BIOS might have been corrupted, so I tried a different one from the retroweb, but that didn't fix the issue. Perhaps inserting the CPU the wrong way caused some damage to the motherboard chipset, and the cache-related pins were not working. But I checked both the KEN and flash pins on the oscilloscope and seemed to show some normal activity. At this point, I had run out of ideas, so I moved on to some other project. A couple of weeks later, I revisited the broken board. I redid some of the tests, and indeed the board was still broken, it didn't magically fix itself. I googled the problem, and to my surprise there was a post about the exact same issue on a VCF forum. And this solution was quite embarrassing. It was down to the turbo switch. I checked my motherboard, and the turbo jumper was on. I removed it and rerun the tests. Cache check now reported that the caches were working just fine. Same with spitzes, everything looks as expected. And both Doom and Quake run fine. This was very embarrassing. I had spent several hours trying to debug the issue, thinking of some complicated failures, but it turns out it was something as simple as a turbo jumper. This makes me wonder if the previous owner of this board had done this on purpose, or if it was configured like this by accident. Perhaps they used the computer for several years without realizing that it could run much faster than it actually did. Anyway, back to the board. One thing I noticed is that the voltage regulation transistor is not flat against the board, so it is not being cooled by the PCB, which can't be good if I end up using a 3V CPU in the future. So let's fix it. The hole on the transistor is not very well aligned with the hole on the PCB, but I think a small 2.5mm screw will fit. Okay, let's add some thermal paste. Oops, I think I added way too much. We only need a very small amount, so let's remove most of it. Okay, it took me quite a bit of time to clean up the mess, but I think it looks alright. I'm now pretty happy with this motherboard. It is still working after I accidentally short-circuited it by inserting a CPU the wrong way, and it even has a battle scar to remind me of this story. Overall, it seems to be working reasonably well. Okay, that's all for now. I hope you enjoyed the video and that you learned from all my embarrassing mistakes. Thanks for watching, and please always remember to insert your 486 CPU the right way.